Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church Live. This is Pastor Donnie, and our live broadcast will be starting very soon. Thanks for watching today, and we pray that you'll be blessed by the praiseful singing, and you'll also be benefited by the scriptural preaching of God's Word. Bethel Baptist Church is located in the northwestern section of North Carolina, United States of America. Today, this broadcast will literally be seen around the world. But if you are ever in our area, we certainly would love to have you visit with us. Our address is 3656 Mountain View Road, North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Service times at Bethel Baptist Church are on, and our live broadcast will be starting very soon. Thanks for watching today, and we pray that you'll be blessed by the praiseful singing, and you'll also be benefited by the scriptural preaching of God's Word. Bethel Baptist Church is located in the northwestern section of North Carolina, United States of America. Today, this broadcast will literally be seen around the world. But if you are ever in our area, we certainly would love to have you visit with us. Our address is 3656 Mountain View Road, North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Service times at Bethel Baptist Church are every Sunday morning, 9:45 for Sunday school, and then 11 a.m. for the worship service every Wednesday night at 7 p.m., and then the fourth Sunday evening at 6 p.m. Thanks again for watching today. Our live feed broadcast should be starting very shortly. God bless you is our prayer. Well, hello, and this is Pastor Donnie, and I want to welcome you today. Thank you, Lord, for you being with us as we're coming together with the means of the internet, and we're broadcasting this evening from the parsonage. We thank the Lord for all his bountiful blessings. Just a few announcements this evening as we're looking to God's Word in just a few moments. We're doing our study on the church covenant. We're continuing tonight with that good study on the church covenant. What marvelous teaching in the church covenant is found. What great truths that is found for us all to discover in the church covenant. Just a couple of announcements quickly this evening. First of all, I want to thank everyone for the efforts that's been put forth for our Vacation Bible School. And we will have the t-shirts that were ordered. If you ordered one, we have your name and your shirt size, and the shirt that you ordered, they're $6 a piece. And we do appreciate you wanting a Bible School t-shirt. What a blessing that is. And we'll have them for you on Sunday, Lord willing. And then secondly, I want you to remember our revival meeting will begin Monday evening at 7 o'clock with Brother Dwayne Moore. And we appreciate Brother Moore. He's no stranger here. Great preacher, a great Bible expository preacher of the Word of God. And we thank the Lord for Brother Moore. He will be with us from Monday to Friday next week, and we're looking forward to hearing him preach. I know the weather may be unsettled for next week, and if it is, we're gonna make some efforts and do some things to try to be able to broadcast irregardless of what the weather is, and hopefully we'll be able to have outdoor services next week. But we're looking forward to that every night, 7 p.m., and I hope and pray that you will come and seek a blessing. And if we're not able to meet together, that we will be attentive to come together and give that time, and that we might worship the Lord around the technology that God has given for us and to us. And then I'd ask you to remember Brother Bill and Sister Tony Shoemate in your prayers. Brother Bill had surgery yesterday, so I'm asking you to pray. Please pray for him, and let's remember him today, and then as he's recovering. And then Sister Tony, his wife, will be having surgery tomorrow, so we need to be much in prayer for her. Also, I'd ask you to pray for Brother Bobby Hawkins, who has been sick, and just ask you to remember him, if you would, please. And then I have a very focused and very special prayer request that I would ask you to remember some circumstances that the Lord, we're looking to Him, trusting Him to intervene and have His will and way. And I'm just asking you to help us pray for these special requests. And then also, I'd ask you to remember a very special couple, Larry and Susie White. Ask you to pray for them tonight with some special needs in their life as well. So with that said, let's pray for one another and remember these requests of prayer. Remember the revival meeting and let's pray for one another. Amen. May we go to the Lord in prayer together tonight and let's just do that this time. Father, God, in Jesus' name, Lord, we come to you this evening. And Lord, we thank you, God, for your word, your promises, Lord. And Lord, we sure love you this evening. And Lord, I pray right now, God, that you would help us, Lord, in every way. God, I pray for the needs, Lord, that have been mentioned here tonight. Lord, the special request of prayer. Lord, for those that are sick, those that are facing surgery. Lord, those that are recovering from surgery, those that are sick at home and shut in and can't get out. Lord, you know the need. Lord, I'm so glad you do. Lord, we pray, God, specifically for Brother Bill and Sister Tony and Brother Bobby and, Lord, a host of others, Lord, in our church, Lord, that need your touch. And, Lord, for these special requests of prayer that's upon our heart, Lord, we pray, God, that you just have your will and way, first of all, and that you'd get the honor and the glory for it all. And, Lord, I thank you, and I look to you, and we trust you in advance. And, Lord, we want to thank you now for what you're going to do, and I ask it tonight. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. I trust that you've had a good week this week so far, and we're going to look tonight back at something I think will be a help to you. You know, one of the things that I miss at Bethel Baptist Church during this season that we are in is good singing. And our choir, the Bethel Baptist Choir, is a wonderful choir. God has blessed the choir many, many times over, and we are so blessed to be a part of Bethel Baptist Church. But we do have the means to look back upon some of the things that we have been able to do in the past. And with that said, we're going to look tonight, or actually going to listen tonight, to the Bethel Baptist Church choir. And they're going to sing a couple of songs. Choir's going to sing a couple for us. And then we'll be back with the lesson from the Word of God and about the church covenant after that. So I hope it'll be a help to you tonight. And let's listen to the Bethel Baptist Church Choir sing a couple of songs for us this evening. May it bless your heart.
victory that was once held. Because of that victory, one day we shall see Jesus.
We shall see Jesus. Shall
Many of you were there that day on that Sunday when we had that wonderful service, and the sweet Spirit of God was very evident in the house of the Lord. It tells me of several things about just looking at that video of the choir and the singing and the sweet fellowship and the power of God. And it makes me miss the singing. It makes me miss the fellowship. And it helps us to understand even greater often what we have taken for granted. And we should never, ever take worship and the great move of God for granted. And we need God in the hour in which we live. And I hope you enjoyed the songs this evening, and hope it was a blessing to you. And now let's take our copy of the Church Covenant, and we're going to begin our study tonight. And I'll try to be as considerate of the time as possible. And let's look together in the Church Covenant. And if you have your copy, I'm going to read down to the place where we're going to look tonight at a very, very important section in the covenant. The covenant begins by saying, having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of God, to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, we do now, in the presence of God and this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. We engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit. And let me just interject the thought. We can do nothing without Him. We need Him. And we engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit to walk together in Christian love. That means not separated, but walking together, united and with one mind and one accord. We engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines, to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expense of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations. Then the writer goes on to say in the paragraph that we're going to be focusing on tonight, it says this: we also engage to maintain family and secret devotions, to religiously educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger. And now, I want you to notice the phrase that he uses: to abstain from the sale and use of destructive drugs or intoxicating drinks as a beverage, to shun pornography. Realizing that in the original church covenant, pornography and destructive drugs was not in that document at that time. But it has been added in a revision, which I think is very appropriate. May we pray once again tonight as we look to God, and we need His help tonight to help us all as we search the scriptures and take the covenant and apply it to our life. Father, we love You, and God, I pray right now that You just help us for the next few moments. Lord, I pray, God, You clear our minds and our hearts. Lord, may we be free of any sin. Lord, may You speak to us and help us, and God, teach us. And we thank You in advance for what You're going to do. And I do ask it tonight in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, we have read in the church covenant about what we are to abstain from. And I want you to notice tonight, it is our responsibility. And it is a great responsibility. And here He is. He's addressing one of the outward responsibilities that we as Christians should perform for everyone's benefit. And he's talking about the use and sale of drugs and alcohol and how we are to shun pornography. Can I say drugs and alcohol and pornography are probably the three biggest issues of our time? And I'll say that without apology. And I believe that drugs, alcohol, and pornography are the three biggest issues of our time. A lot of people would disagree with that. But if you think about it, now just think with me for a moment, because all three of these things affect the human mind. The human brain is greatly attacked by each one of these. And if you're a person that drinks alcohol, you know it affects your mind. If you take drugs, you know it affects your mind. But I'm going to say this, if you're addicted to pornography, and if you look at pornography, it also affects your mind. So these three areas of the mind, God wants us to be healthy in our minds, to have a sound mind, as Dr. Shepherd preached on a couple of Sundays ago, about having that sound mind, not being afraid, but having a sound mind. And you'll not have a sound mind addicted to drugs or alcohol or pornography. I want to just to say a couple of things here, and we're going to get right into the study, but the human brain is simply amazing. If you think about it and you study the brain, the temporal lobe of the brain, that's where emotions are stored and actually where decisions are made. And so I'm not going to make any puns about that. But the temporal lobe of the brain. The brain has several different sections, and each section is unique in its design to work all together to help us to be who we are. There are places, there's another lobe in the brain that where images and colors are visually, and vision is actually processed. There's another place in the brain where cognition, and that means the processing of our minds, where that works. There's another place in the brain called the frontal lobe. And if you study it, it's where the options of are weighted by logic and motivation. And so in that frontal lobe, there's where a lot of your thinking, your logic comes from, and also your motivation to do things. And and then there's another place called the cerebellum, and it looks like a little brain. And it's very interesting as you look at the brain, if you have a picture of it, the brain, and then there's another, looks like a smaller brain. But that is very important because that part of the brain is what the motor skills and the muscle movement is used there to. You couldn't move without that part of your brain, and you couldn't have motor skills. You wouldn't have muscle movement if it were not for that part of the brain. And then the brainstem, and we don't often think about that, but the brainstem actually controls the messages between the brain and the rest of the body. So you think about it. The brain is a wonderful thing that God created, and he put it in us, and the brainstem actually, it also controls a lot of other things, such as our breathing and our swallowing. It controls your heart rate and your blood pressure. It is an amazing thing. The human brain, very complicated, and all those important parts that make up the human brain. It's no wonder the psalmist David used these words in Psalms 139 and verse 14. He said, "I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well." As I'm thinking about that, we should be thankful that God has given us a brain. And think about the many things the brain does. And think about the blessing it is to have a brain that works. And thank God for that. So we need to think about the mind and the brain tonight. And here it is in the church covenant that we realize that there's a warning placed for us to understand, because Can I tell you, we have an enemy tonight, and Satan wants to destroy you. He wants to attack you, and he will if we allow him to, if we give him a venue, if we give him an avenue, he will attack us. And oftentimes, here are three of the biggest ways that he comes against humanity today. Number one, it's drugs, and number two, it's alcohol, and number three, it's pornography. In the hour in which we live, the devil has got a stronghold, and he has it, and he's getting into the minds of men, and he's destroying them from the inside. I'm going to deal with each one of these just for a few moments and tonight, and I'm going to try to hurry through it, but I want you to understand that there is a danger tonight of drugs. And I'm not just talking about street drugs. I'm talking about there is in our society, and especially right here where we live, there is an abuse of prescription drugs. Now you think with me for just a moment. That's taking something that has been prescribed by a doctor and filled by a pharmacist, and it's absolutely legal. And so you take that, and then somehow or another, those drugs get out of the hand of the person that is supposed to have them, and then they're taken and they're used for something else other than what they are prescribed to be used for. The abuse of prescription drugs can consist of many things. And as I'm thinking about this, drug abuse has no age limits, from children all the way to the elderly. And I want to warn us all this evening as I'm thinking about it. The Mayo Clinic says this, and I quote, "The main drugs abused are painkillers called opiates and anxiety medicines and sedatives and stimulant drugs." And so it's interesting as you look up this research on what these hospitals and doctors are telling us, is that addicts often seek drugs from more than one doctor. And these people are called drug seekers. And they go to doctor, and they make up things, they say things, and they get prescriptions, and then they get them filled. They're drug seekers. And it's sad. They'll come up with the idea to lose a prescription. They'll lose a prescription. They say they lost it. Or they'll steal meds from family and friends. 80% of people the age of 60 and above who go to the doctor have at least one prescribed medication. And lots and lots of people that go to the doctor that are that age and above have multiple prescriptions. So I want to warn you today that you have a responsibility to keep your medicines put away. I'm going to just say that. You have a responsibility to be responsible for your family, and not only just your children, but your grandchildren or anyone that comes into your home. You see, teens and adults abuse prescription meds, and they do it for many reasons. Sometimes they do it to get high. Sometimes they do it to feel good. Sometimes they do it to relax. Sometimes they'll steal it and take it to relieve tension. Sometimes they do it to lose weight or increase alertness. And they use these drugs oftentimes to experiment with the effects of the substance. So I'm saying that drug abuse is something we need to all understand, and no one is immune from this. You're just because you go to church and you're trying to live right, and it doesn't mean that somebody in your family wouldn't get hooked on drugs from your medicine cabinet. So I'm warning tonight that we need to be cautious when it comes to these very things. And sometimes people will use these drugs to be socially accepted or to be cool amongst their peers. And many of them, teenagers, will do it for that reason. And some of them even try to enhance their academics by taking drugs. And I don't know if that works or not, but that's what the study said. But sadly to say, but we read today, and if you pick up our newspaper right here, the Wilkes Journal Patriot, and if you look at the Wilkes paper and either one of the papers that's here in this county or the Winston-Salem papers, if you read the newspaper and if you go to the obituary column, sadly to say, you're going to read about people that had a drug problem. And oftentimes it is prescription drugs. And so I'm warning us all, we need to be cautious. Well, you ask, well, what can I do to ensure it doesn't happen in my family? Well, you can know what your medication does, and you should. You should ask the doctor, the pharmacist, about what this medicine could do to someone else that doesn't have the ailment that it's used to help. What would it do for that person? And we shouldn't use other people's prescriptions, just to be honest. And we should talk about the dangers of prescription drugs with your children. I'm going to be honest with you. I've preached way too many funerals. I don't ever, ever want to have to stand over a coffin of someone who was a young person who overdosed on prescription drugs. I just don't want to do it. That's why I'm taking this tonight. And I'm giving you some startling facts about prescription drugs in your home. Can I ask you, where do you keep them right now? Are they in a secure place? Are they locked up? Do you keep record of how many pills is in each bottle? And when they go out of the bottle, where do they go? Do you know for sure? Can I tell you, you say, well, it never happened. My little Johnny or my little Susie, I want to say this, little Johnnies and little Susies can get on prescription drugs and they can do it and they can sneak around and do it and they can do it behind your back. Don't give an opportunity for the devil to come into your home and to use something that you have there to help you to be better, but make them and worse by destroying their life. Can I warn you this evening? We should be cautious and we should warn our children about the dangers of prescription drugs. We need to keep them locked up and we need to keep a log of those drugs. And let me just say this, get rid of the unnecessary medications that you have. Get rid of them. Just get rid of them. Now get them disposed of rightly. Don't just pour them out. Don't just throw them in the trash. Don't pour them down the drain. Amen. But get rid of them in the proper fashion. Let me just say this. Overdoses and death happen regularly, and they're happening right here in Wilkes County. According to the Center for Disease Control, 46 people die every day from drug overdose involving prescription opiates. And it's sad to think that. And not only is there the legal drugs that we have to, the prescription drugs that we have to think of, but then there again, there is the illegal drugs. And most of you are aware that just a few days ago, there was a big drug arrest here in our area, and many, many million, thousands and thousands of dollars worth of very hard and illegal drugs was confiscated. Can I tell you, child of God, we have no business messing with any kind of drugs, legal or illegal, either one. We should not be involved in the selling of drugs, destructive drugs, or anything that is harmful and addictive. And let me just say this, if you experience with meth, you'll be hooked just like that. You better not ever touch it. The best thing to do is to withdraw yourself from anybody that wants you to take such a narcotic, because it's very dangerous and we don't know what addictions it will bring. Certainly we have laws that we have in our nation. They have been established to help us and to keep us from dangerous addictions and drugs. And these illegal drugs, Christians should not, we shouldn't have anything to do with them. And we should abide by the law of the land as long as it does not go contrary to the Word of God. And we should respect our bodies that God has given unto us and not to abuse ourselves with drugs, prescription, legal or illegal, either way. And sadly to say, I've seen it in a lot of churches. I know Christian people that profess to be saved and they can get addicted to drugs. And it's very sad to see that. And you know it as well as I do. You know people in your life that you know personally, probably, very likely, that are addicted to drugs. And it's a very dangerous thing, because what you're doing is you're letting the devil affect your mind. And we should not allow it to be a part of our life. Abstaining from the selling of drugs or using drugs is common sense for a saved, born-again believer in Christ. Yet, you might not believe this, but in 2019, last year, as far as I know, and this is the record that I have found, 198,000 people were in prisons and jails all across the United States, and they were imprisoned because of drugs. It is a serious, serious matter, and we should take it that way. Sir, ma'am, mom, dad, grandpa, grandma, put a lock on the medicines, put them away, put them out of reach, put them out of sight, keep a record of them. I want to encourage you, don't allow someone in your family to be tempted by something that you have that you could do something about right now. Can I challenge you to think about the drugs that you have in your home right now and do something about it today? And don't wait, because you don't know what will happen tomorrow. 1 Thessalonians 5:21, the Bible says, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. And in verse number 21, or 22 rather, he says this, abstain from all appearance of evil. And we need to be good stewards and use that brain that we have to do what God would have us to do and to take care of our families. Now, the second area the church covenant deals with is not only drugs, but it is alcohol. And I think that most of you understand the danger of alcohol. The church covenant says to abstain from the sale and use of, and then it says, destructive drugs or intoxicating drinks as a beverage. Now, let me just say this tonight, and let me just clarify something really clearly tonight. I am not the judge, and neither are you. And listen carefully what I'm going to say. I would personally not want to sell alcoholic drinks. I would not want to pour liquor out and put it before people that they would put the liquor, the bottle to their mouth. I would not want a job where I did that. But I'm just going to say this. I've heard some people who criticize people who work at a store or a restaurant, and maybe they don't have anything to do with bringing alcohol in. Maybe it's a corporate decision and someone has a job and a responsibility. I am not the judge, and neither are you, because I'm going to say this. Most of you shop Walmart. Most of you shop Lowe's Foods. Most of you shop Food Lion, Just Save. And I'm just going to be honest with you. If you're a critic of somebody that works at a place like this, listen carefully what I'm going to say. If you criticize them for working there, you're part of the problem, because you are sponsoring that by giving your money and purchasing their goods through that store, and you're helping. You say, well, I'm not buying the alcohol and I'm not selling it. No, but you're helping them make that establishment an establishment by going and patronizing it and buying your groceries there. And you see, there's very few places you can go in this world, in our society today, that does not, very few stores. But if I own the store, I would not have alcohol in. If I own the restaurant, I'm going to give a responsibility of that. And so will an account for that. And so will the owners. And so will the board of directors of these companies that cause other people to have to handle alcohol. I would not want to be a beer salesman. I would not want to be a wine salesman. I would not want to pour liquor. I would not want to pour it in a glass and hand it to people. I don't want that responsibility. But I want you to know that we need to be cautious and careful how we approach that and how we think about it, because other people that have jobs in supermarkets, I mean, their whole idea is they sell other things there besides alcohol. And see, I've heard so many people criticize someone who works in a food market or in a convenience store, and it's a result of that. And it's not their decision to put alcohol in there, but it is the owner or the board of director. And I'm going to say this, let God be the judge of that. You go by your conscience, okay? And it's the same thing about eating out. Some people say, I won't eat at a restaurant that serves alcohol. And some people say that it doesn't bother them. Well, let God be the one to convict you. And let God lead you in your job and in your career. Let the Lord be God and let Him be the judge of it. And let Him show you what you need to do rather than letting somebody else be your judge for you, okay? And just that's just the way I feel about it. But you know how I feel about alcohol. Alcohol is one of the devil's tools that he uses to destroy families and homes. He's destroyed many, many families. There's been divorces. There have been families torn apart by alcohol. Not only families torn apart, but lives have been destroyed because of alcohol. And we should be cautious when it comes to alcohol. Christians should not partake of any type of alcoholic beverage. I do not believe, according to the Word of God, I think that we need to abstain from alcohol altogether. You say, well, I can drink a drink and it doesn't bother me. You're right, you can. But you know what? It may destroy your children. They may not be able to handle it like you think you can, and you may not be able to handle it like you can either, sir or ma'am. I want to warn you tonight, the Bible says in Proverbs 20 and verse number 1, wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Don't be deceived by alcohol. It affects the mind. It's addictive, and you can get addicted to it, and your body will crave it. And once you begin that addiction, you have to have more, and you have to have more, and pretty soon you're caught in the snare, and you cannot get out. Can I warn you? You'd be far better off to never start something that you'll have to have a real problem to ever get out of. It has destroyed so many lives, so many families. It has caused divorces. It's caused divorces. It's caused deaths. It's devastated the lives of thousands of children. So I want to warn us about alcohol. And let me give you one more, and I'm going to come swiftly to a conclusion tonight. Last thing that is added in our church covenant here in our topic tonight is drugs and alcohol and to shun pornography. Now, can I warn you tonight about pornography? Pornography is wickedness, and it's wrong, and it's sinful, and it is available. It is available. You're one click away. If you have internet access, if you have a smartphone, and if you have a computer, if you have a television with internet access, you are one click away from pornography. And the Bible has a lot to say about how we are to relate to the opposite sex. And let me just say this tonight. You're talking about the brain. Did you know the brain has inroads? And when you allow something to come into your mind for the first time, you know what it does? It's just kind of like Daniel Boone, when he came through this area, he blazed a trail. That means that he cut the road. He cut a road out, a trail, as he went through. And we think about that. Even to this day, there is a place called Boone Trail. There's a road named Boone Trail. Why is that? Because Daniel Boone came through and he blazed a trail. But can I tell you, your mind is so complex. And when you blaze a trail into your mind with pornography, and you go back again and you come back again, it does not take that same little narrow path. What it does, it expands itself every time that you allow pornography to become an inroad into your mind. It expands that road and it wants to become a superhighway. And what it means is, there's more and more and more and more and more. Every time that you bring it into your mind, your mind broadens and it's less satisfying. In other words, you'll never be satisfied with that kind of life, allowing that wickedness to enter in. What pornography does, it leads to more and more wickedness. And it does every time. Statistically, it's very true. Study it out for yourself. Can I warn you tonight? Pornography is something, mom and dad, listen to me carefully. You have children that have cell phones. Do you look at their cell phone? Do you see what they look? You say, well, my little Johnny, I look at his phone and he's never done anything. Can I tell you, little Johnny's smarter than you are, mom and dad, about how to get rid of and cover his trail? Amen. If he's doing that kind of stuff, you better bet your bottom dollar. And I don't bet, but I'd be willing to say that little Johnny, if he's smart enough to look at that and know that you're going to be looking at his phone, he's smart enough to Google how to cover his tracks. Are y'all hearing me this evening? Can I tell you, it's a dangerous thing to give young children, even preteens, teenagers, to give them free access. It's like giving them a loaded gun and say, spin the barrel, spin the chamber, and play Russian roulette. Can I tell you, it's a dangerous, dangerous thing. You say, my child would never do it, and I hope and pray they wouldn't. But what about the ones that do and that you don't know about? Could I say this? I believe probably and possibly that pornography is one of the greatest hindrances to real revival in the hour in which we live. When Christians are addicted to pornography, and it's just a click away. It's just a click away. And you say, well, I might not, but you know what? Even you look at Facebook and you look at some of these things and how they're becoming more and more vile. And I see it, and it's there on the Facebook. And you better be careful. You better be careful. Your teenage son, your teenage daughter, they need to be warned of pornography. It will destroy them. Sir, can I tell you, pornography will take you down the road when you won't be satisfied with your wife. She won't be able to please you when you have the idea and you allow pornography to have that super highway into your life. You will no longer love her the way that God wants you to love her. It will affect your relationship. Ma'am, it will do the same for you. Young person, it will give you the wrong idea of what marriage is and what family is and the responsibility of the wedding vows. It will give you the wrong impression. Can I warn you enough tonight about pornography? It is a dangerous tool. It is of Satan. It is of hell. And can I warn you tonight? It is a sad hour in which we live. I have some statistics here that I could give you about pornography. And one of them, and let me just throw out just a couple here, and I'm going to close this evening. But I want us to be warned about drugs and about alcohol and pornography. Can I say this, mom and dad? If your young person is staying up late, if they're hiding what is on their screen, if they're locking the door, it's possible that they're making inroads, and they already have inroads, and they're being developed into their head by pornography. I believe today it's in epidemic portions. I really do. And it could be in your home. It could be in your home. You need to check. You need to make sure. And every once in a while, wouldn't hurt to go by and just say, what are you looking at? Amen. It wouldn't. And I'm just being honest. It's very sad to think about all the things about pornography. Pornography, according to statistics, porn sites receive more regular traffic than Netflix, Amazon, and Twitter combined each month. 35% of all internet downloads are porn rated or related. 34% of the internet users have been exposed to unwanted porn in via ads or pop-ups. And I want to say this, children are being robbed of their innocency. The teen porn category has toppled porn site searches for the last 6 years. How sad that is. At least 30% of all data transferred across the internet is porn related. And there's many, many more. Porn is a global estimated $97 billion a year industry, with about $2 billion dollars of that coming from the United States of America. How sad it is. In 2018 alone, more than 5,517 million hours of porn were consumed by the world's largest porn site. And it's just sad. I got more statistics I could give you on and on. It goes on about all these terrible things. The world's largest free porn site also received 33,500,000,000 site visits during 2018 alone. How sad it is. How sad it is. It's destroying lives and it's getting into the mind. What does the devil want to do? He wants to control your mind. And he can do that by drugs, by alcohol, and by pornography. Those three things, those are the three issues. And during this virus, you think about it. Alcohol sales through the roof. Amen, it is. And I'm sure drugs are through the roof. And pornography, no doubt, through the roof. Because people were looking for something to do. Because their life's been disrupted. They're discouraged. They're looking for something. And sadly to find, the devil is filling their minds with drugs, alcohol, and pornography. It's a lot to think about tonight. I pray that you'll check your medicine chest. I pray that you'll check your children and see what they're watching. I would pray, sir, that if you have a porn addiction, that you fall on your face and cry out to God and ask Him to forgive you. And if it takes breaking your phone in two to break that addiction, do it. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. If it's a temptation for you, get rid of it. Remove it from your life. Remove it from your home. Amen. And you'll see what God will do. Could be the greatest hindrance to revival in our lifetime is these three things, and especially pornography. May God bless you tonight. I love each one of you, and I appreciate you so very much. And we're going to close tonight. We're going to listen again to the Bethel Baptist Church Choir, and they're going to sing that first song again that they sang, and we're just going to close with that, I think, tonight. May God bless you. We love each one of you. Looking forward to seeing you, Lord willing, on Sunday morning. Thanks again. Bye-bye.